We don't have quite as much of a hitchiness. The frame rate looked okay. Everything looked fairly smooth, but there is a little bit of lag on the input on my end. So just try to clean that up a little bit.
I wouldn't worry about it too much. I mean, there was a couple of people that were complaining about FPS drops, but that's almost entirely due to their internet because we can only stream at your source quality, which is 1080p. So
Yeah. All right.
are we
So
back?
we are back. We've actually been back.
We're back. We've been back. Okay, great. Well,
I
let me
was
just
not
take this
kidding about the
opportunity.
5 second black
No,
spot.
you weren't. You have stayed true to your word. Let me just give an update. We've now got 21 votes for Zlo versus Luxie. That's pretty cool. Pretty cool that we're gonna see. Okay, that's a fair amount. That's 44% of people have chosen to watch the Zlo versus Luxie match in comparison to the 35% that have chosen to watch the Ajax versus Obfuscation match. So it looks like that one is gonna go ahead as far as I am concerned. And they may already be playing, if I'm not mistaken. They may
Okay, let
already
me
be
go in
playing.
and check.
I think they might very well be. It was a fairly long time ago that the
Yes.
map was announced.
Let me go ahead and see if we can actually get into that game.
Okay.
And if we can, that will be fantastic. We may get black screen. May have to wait a little longer.
That's okay. That
Everyone
is
cross your
absolutely
fingers.
fine. Mine are
Ah!
crossed. No.
Launch!
Oh. It looks like it's ready to go. Fantastic. That's what
We
we like to see.
are forward, moving onward with the cast. Okay, so Zlo versus Luxie. We've actually got a different faction set up this time. We've got Zlo taking Seraphim, which is the old familiar territory on the south end, and then Luxie breaking out the Cybran banner. Finally, somebody choosing the right faction in this tournament.
Would you say that the Cybern is your favorite faction to play? I mean,
It
I'm just
is.
guessing by that.
It really
Okay,
is.
fair enough. Okay, why is that? Why is that?
Patrick Pone's commenting, well, of course he's chosen Cybern. He's a top player.
Okay, so we watched a match with Luxie in last time. Now we're seeing a match with Zloin, who I have had turn up to a couple of my streams before. You are a little bit you know what some of the players are capable of. So who do you think has got this game? Is it in the bag? Is it going to be a hotly contested game? I mean, it's worth pointing out that Zlo did win his last game, and I think he won it in a fairly efficient timescale as well. So I'm not entirely sure. What
I
do you think?
am
What do you think?
uncomfortable guessing, and Zlo is doing something very strange here. He's actually walking forward to speed build his Hydro. So you can see he's going to have this massive, massive, well, that's repetitively redundant, a massive mass income. And he's going to jump to that Hydro at the very front there while reclaiming some tree to make up the power difference. Whereas Luxie is going for the hyper aggressive pose. Getting that air factory online early, pushing out with some engineers instead of walking with the ACU. Probably going to get an early bomber out there like he did last game. So this is, I think this is going to end up being a powerhouse land spam versus a balanced game. So this is going to be interesting to watch to see how this shapes up.
So it looks like we're going to see Zlo going for the slightly more conservative play, the less aggressive play in comparison to Luxie's. Is that
Well, he
about
is dropping an air
correct?
factory, so he is going to match
Oh,
Luxie. Just
wow.
a little bit different build order, different
Okay.
methodology.
However, if we see an early bomber from Luxie, then that could do some damage to the expansion prospects, although obviously that air factory still hasn't gone down, so doesn't look like
Yes.
a bomber is going to be able to do too much damage, although, could still do something. You never
Zlo is
know.
going to get his air online earlier, I think, because Luxie is only building with the ACU, and Zlo is building with the ACU plus two engineers. See how speedy that factory is coming online. Going
That is
for a land factory next.
absolutely fine. Absolutely fine. So a land factory is going down and another one after that. So a fair few
Luzun.
lined up.
75% on Luzun's factory and completion for Zlo. So nice little run build there. That actually worked out way better than I thought it would. for Zlo. So even footing, 11 mass income, around 200 power income for both of these guys, and getting that air factory down early.
Good. Good to see. Very, very, very good to see. So we're starting to see a little bit of expansion from both of the players, which is interesting. It's also interesting to note that it looks like that scout that came out belonged to Luxie. So the first air unit that graces the field is Luxie's. Interesting.
Yes. Very, and we've got Interceptor first for Zlo, Interceptor for Luxie as well. So no early bomber play, at least for the first couple of minutes. They both got Interceptors out, taking the defensive posture.
Okay. Okay, that is looking pretty good. It looks like...
Excellent micro from Zlo.
Yeah, going to get the pickoff right there. And once again with the scout. Wow. This is, you know, you can tell this is top level plays. The mistakes are just non-existent, really, are they?
Yep. We've got raiding units moving towards the south side. Of course, Cybern is going to have the early advantage on this one because of the speedy Mantis. But the Tham is the second fastest tank. It is one tick faster than UEF. So, it's not going to be quite as easy to get a run by for Luxie, although, let's see, he is actually going to pursue the tank and try to stop it because that is going to move up. So they're crossing each other, double potential there. They can either catch the opposing tank as it passes and try to kill it, or if they don't meet any resistance, they can move ahead right on in and kill off some expansioneers. So,
It's interesting to note that both ACUs are down the same side of the map. Now, that's not something we actually saw in the last game between Luxie and Mad Mozart. So, you know, there could be some ACU competition. You know, there could be some ACU
calm
jousting.
Calm brutality.
Exactly. Which I am totally down with. I just want to put that out there. I am totally down with some calm-on-calm action. That is totally cool. Totally, totally cool.
Someone in chat betting $100 on Zlo winning.
It's actually really, really good to see, but there's a lot of people who, they're fairly different in who they think is going to win. So there's a lot of people that think Zlo is going to win. There is Ajax. Is it Ajax? I don't really know if it's Ajax.
I've always called him Ajax. That's probably not the correct pronunciation, but whatever.
Whatever. I mean, yeah. I don't entirely know. It's from Finland, apparently. Finland. I did not know that. Oh, well. Interesting. Interesting indeed. Fantastic. Okay, so this game is progressing very, very nicely. And you mentioned that the Cybern has got this early advantage. So does the Cybern have a time limit on when it can win by? Is that what you're saying?
Not versus Seraphim.
Okay.
Because they're going to have... the only difficulty that Cybern is going to have is at the T2 stage versus the Ilshiva, which pretty much goes for all the factions. The Rhino is a pretty stout tank. You can kind of counter the Ilshivas with some hoplites and some careful micro, but T2 is always a little bit rough versus Seraphim. But T1, Mantis is faster. T3, the brick is stronger than any of the options that the Seraphim will have at their disposal. So Cybern... Usually Cybern's on the back foot, kind of tends to have a little bit weaker unit, but in this particular instance, they are going to have the upper hand for the majority of the game, I would say, as long as there's not a huge income disparity.
Okay, so hypothetically, when Zlo decides to go for Tier 2, that could be sort of an endgame move once he brings out the Ilshivas and starts expressing his dominance upon the field. So... is that potentially an endgame scenario?
Depends on how well he's holding map control and how much damage he can do at the T2 stage. Okay. If he makes it work for him really, really well, then yeah, T2 could absolutely end this. We just got a map freeze, which may or may not be indicative of the game ending. And I was about to comment on the fact that Zlo is doing a fantastic job harassing Luxie. You see, we've got tanks moving up through the mid right here. Two mass extractors down, moving towards the back. And then we've only got four Mantis on this side, which may be able to do some damage over here. But overall, Zlo looks like he's got a pretty good handle on what's going on.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure. Absolutely. It really looks like Zlo is much more spread out on the map, and it looks like he knows where he is. He's got his positioning down, so that's good. It's really good.
I have to wait and see if this. I have to wait and see if this unfreezes.
I think it will. I hope so. Anyway, fingers crossed. I've got my fingers crossed very, 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 very tightly. All right. So, who in the chat thinks that that Luxy is going to win, or Zlo is going to win? Could these guys be the people that are in the final? Because I'm really not sure. It's going to be very, very interesting to see who progresses through this tournament.
Well, and is there a final? I don't think there is. I think it's just 5 rounds, and basically it's points accumulation.
That's a good point. I completely forgot that this was a Swiss tournament or whatever you call it.
I was correct. The game has already ended. I did not realize that swiping to the tournament screen would actually spoil that.
has the game ended?
It has already been recorded. Zlo walking away with the win on that one. But the other 3 games have not been decided yet. So we can go and grab another game if you would prefer.
Luxy is saying, sorry, parents are here. I don't see them very often. That is a guy who knows his priorities, all right? You know, I can appreciate that. You know, he's dropping out of a major tournament, a major FAF tournament to go see his folks. You know what? I can appreciate that.
Was TA for Life second highest on the voting?
Oh, good question. Let me just check. It was Ajax versus Obfuscation. That's who,
so we're going
that's
for Ajax.
Who it was.
All right.
Ajax. Okay.
Let's crack this game open and hit a couple plus on the speed.
Okay. Yeah, no. Okay, so Zocky Zock is saying Zlo destroyed Luxy so hard that he leaves the tournament. If his parents are there, he shouldn't have joined the tournament in the first place. Wow, the shots are being fired right now. Holy crap. Holy crap.
Salty tournament is living up to its name.
Wow. Two major players have already, you know, almost salted themselves out. I mean, Luxy rage quitting, and earlier Mozart almost rage quit. So, wow, this whole Himalayan salt is really, you know, sticking true to
Himalayan
its name.
Himalayan salt is the highest and strongest variety. All right, so this is going to be Ajax versus Obfuscation. I'm going to go ahead and call the names out there so Potato doesn't have to. And,
oh, thank God. Thank you. Thank you. Finally,
it's
somebody
gonna
who understands my plight.
It's going to be UEF versus Cybern. We've got a classic SUPCOM matchup, the original two factions, because we all would like to prefer, or we would all like to forget about the Space Hippies. And
who?
I'm going to have
I genuinely have no idea. Who are the Space Hippies?
The Aeon. I'm going to root for Ajax strictly because he is a clan mate of mine. I do not know if he will prevail, but I'm going to be behind him all the way.
Goodness sake, this is absolute nonsense. I mean, how are you a caster? I mean, you're so biased. I mean, you're blatantly expressing your desire
It was a harder choice than you think it was, because Obfuscation has gone Cybern. So we've got my favorite faction and a clanmate. How do I choose?
Well, the point that I'm trying to make is you shouldn't be choosing. This is, you should be neutral. You should be neutral.
Oh, my goodness. There's no fun in neutrality, and it will not affect the quality of my observations.
No, it's not. I mean, and it's important to note that what you say is going to have literally no impact on the tournament, because these games are all 5 minutes in the past, so
yep.
Hey-ho. It's not going to change anything, I'm afraid. As much as you dearly probably wish it would, it won't change anything. What a shame.
All right. So a little bit of rating coming out for Obfuscation. He is going to get 2 Mantis Scout pairs out. He's going to head up towards the north, try to nail down some of those expansioneers. And it looks like we've got the same kind of denial style running for Ajax, planting a tank and a scout out to the left and right. But handy-dandy bomber. Have to see if he gets a kill with that.
Now, I heard from somebody.
No.
I heard from somebody He didn't get a kill on that, did he? No.
No, he didn't. So the bomber was not worth it.
The bomber was not worth it. Now, I was told by somebody a fair while ago that if somebody manages to get two kills on a bomber, two engineer kills by a bomber, then that makes its mass worth it. So it's worth bearing in mind. It's, bomber.
I'm going to start
totally
putting my
it.
Fingers in my ears and yelling la, 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 la. I like the Mantis grouping on the south side. Obfuscation just absolutely obliterating the face off of that tank. And he is going to run up to the north with a nice little clump of units. So some progress made right there.
Yeah, no, I think that's totally, totally cool. And it looks like the ACUs have elected to go on opposite sides of the map. So unfortunately, I don't think there's going to be any ACU sparring, which is a real shame. Oh well. You know, we can dream.
I have two mechs cleanups. Always nice to eliminate a little bit of economy.
I think that denying mass is super, super important because, you know, the amount of mass per second, that stacks very, very quickly. And if you deny it, then, you know, good on you as far as I'm concerned. That is fantastic.
And this was not as close as I thought it was going to be. Nice little push of tanks over to the left for Ajax, shutting down that run by very handily. And then the same thing basically happening over here with obfuscation. So we're seeing symmetrical gameplay. It's basically musical chairs with ACUs. So we see this ACU heading up into the right expansion and Ajax's commander moving to the left side expansion.
Okay. So, you know, at the moment, we've not seen any players go for the sort of center ground. Is that an area that is going to be hotly contested in the future, or do you reckon that's just going to stay
empty? Kind of a weird spot because you have this little narrow neck that you have to fit units through, which means that units don't flow through it very well. They get clumped up, strung out. You can defend it very easily. Troop movement is slow. There's only 4 mass extractors, whereas there's 4, 6, you know, huge amounts of mass extractors to the sides. So typically, there's going to be some raiding units. Yeah, somebody's going to try to grab it. You can see Ajax moving in right there. But it's really not the main focus, even though it is the dead center of the map.
So, I love it. Obfuscation is going to get yet more mass pickoff. Now, you know, getting 2 mass extractors, it's not a big deal. But getting 4, that's quite substantial.
He's actually going to pick up 6.
6 even, wow. Okay, so he's going to progress to pick up those 2. So
I do like this little bit right here. This is kind of the whole, it is better to accomplish something later than lose your units now mentality. Ajax actually pulling his tanks off because he knows that 4 tanks was not enough to combat all of this. And he's pulling those tanks back to secure this expansion. So he's going to for sure keep these 3 mechs alive instead of losing all of his tanks to not really do anything to save the 6 over here. So he's just going to hole up in the back and hope for the best.
Okay. So down the left side, looks like it's going to be a fairly even battle, but it looks like Obfuscation is going to manage to push Ajax's attempt of pushing back. I mean, the ACU is there to support, so I don't imagine that this is going to go anywhere that is, you know, going to be super, super helpful later on. But maybe
so
that's just me.
So many point defense.
Goodness gracious. Well, you know what? You know what? You can't go wrong with point defense as far as I'm concerned. it's just top notch. I mean, it is, well, for me especially, I'm an absolute noob. Like, in comparison to literally everybody here,
I
am an absolute
noob. Fire Beetles. I'm sorry.
Uh-oh, okay. You got me hyped up for nothing, man. It's okay.
I just had a little mini heart attack. Belle actually walked in the room just then, and I glanced over. And I look back, and all I see is a T1 transport full of units flying straight over in ACU's head. And I instantly thought, oh no, it's a Fire Beetle snipe.
Well, you know what? Ajax is, you know, he's got a whiff of something. He's moving back. He is moving back fairly fast. Wow.
He is, because swarms of Mantis, you do not want to get your ACU stuck in swarms of Mantis because you will end up dead.
Oh, goodness me. Goodness me, that does not sound fun. 6 engineers up there not doing anything. That's a little bit strange. Maybe don't really know why.
They have laid claim to the territory. They may all be within one bomb's AoE of each other. Ah, there we go. They're spreading out.
There we go. Okay, yes. Yeah. Okay.
See, that's the kind of thing that makes you cry when a single bomber comes by and kills all six engineers.
Yeah. Wow. That would not have been great. Obfuscation is going for the gun upgrade, so it looks like his ACU is going to be getting down and dirty. Probably going to be trying to push forward a little bit.
Very aggressive T2 move for Ajax. This is going to be tight.
Going to be tight. Well, I suppose you've got to respond to the fact that the ACU is getting the gun upgrade somehow, and tier 2 is probably a more sustainable long-term way to counter the gun upgrade.
Well, here's the thing. He went T2 before. Obfuscation is actually getting T2 or the gun in response to T2 from Ajax, because the gun commander is actually the perfect counter to early tech, because you're only going to have a few tanks. They're usually going to be clumped up. You can overcharge them very easily. But Ajax has rolled out. Look, he's got 8 factories building pillars. He gave up ground because his unit count went down, because he wasn't building units while he was upgrading his factories. But now that he's got T2, look at how he's just ramming through the center with all of these T2 tanks.
Wow.
Wow. Got a little T2 response right here, but there's just not going to be enough tanks online for Obfuscation to stop this.
That's just nothing. He's really got nothing. That's going to be detrimental, and there's nothing to protect his base. There is one point defense, but that is about it.
He's going to lose a lot of build power back here.
It's going
Could
to hurt.
Potentially lose a lot of his map control as well, although he does seem to be hanging on to it by the skin of his teeth. Lost some mechs in the back, but he is going to be able to survive, I think.
Well, he's got his ACU up there as well to help deal with the tier 2 units, so...
Yeah.
That's going to be an important way to make sure that he maintains some of that map control.
More T2 tanks over to the right-hand side. That was one of the best T2 shifts that I have ever seen. You can see he got equal map control. He held it. He lost ground for about 30 seconds, and then just out of nowhere, bam, huge sucker punch with dozens of T2 tanks, and now they're just everywhere. Obfuscation went... In about a minute's time, he went from pushing 75% map control as far as the expansions are concerned and overwhelming progress to full-on retreat, and he's losing chunks of his outlying eco. So that was just huge, huge swap-up for Ajax.
Wow. It seemed to really, really work, and it looks like Ajax is managing to regain a lot of the lost map control at the moment. I mean, the top right side of the map is that's an area that he should have controlled from the beginning, and it looks like finally he's going to be reclaiming that lost territory, so to speak.
Yes, so triple very, overcharge very right there. That's what I was talking about with the ACU being the perfect counter to clumps of T2 units. Get those overcharges in there, and you can win out pretty easily.
Yep.
All right, yep. Rhinos are on the field, and it looks like Obfuscation is finally getting enough of them in one spot to put up a fight. He's not going to win, hands down. In fact, I think he's going to lose this particular engagement, but it's not just overwhelming progress for Ajax anymore on the left side, so that's good to see.
That is fantastic to see. So, we're almost 15 minutes in. What is your I don't know, mid-game update? Because this is a... How big is this map again?
This is a 10... No, this is... Is this a 5 or a 10? I cannot remember.
I have no idea. It looks...
Someone help! How big is Open Palms? I think it's a 5.
Please. Yeah. Whatever the case, we're 15 minutes in. What is your summary of the game so far? How's it going for both players?
I've still got to stick with my earlier statement. That was one of the best T2 shifts I've seen in a long time from Ajax. That was absolutely flawless. If anybody wants to get a good build order for Twin Palms, for Open Palms, better watch this replay and do what Ajax did.
that was very, very impressive. And I don't think I've ever seen such... me, who hasn't, who's seen almost nothing in the Forged Alliance world, but I've not seen as convincing a shift as that before. I mean, Ajax was definitely on the back foot until he managed to get that tier 2 upgrade, and
yeah,
it's looking amazing for him now. I mean, he's regained control of the top right side of the map, and things are really looking up. I mean, it's looking really good for him.
He's that getting is. The reclaim. One of the biggest things about regaining ground like this is that you get all of the reclaim after you push all these guys out. Oh, Jesters, look at that. They're going to die a horribly painful death versus all of that flak. And there they go.
Wow. Wow, that's a lot of wasted mass right there, unfortunately, for obfuscation. That's a real shame. A real shame.
Wowzers. Oh, okay, wow. People in chat have spoken. It is 10 by 10. You're right. I should have known that. Obviously,
beautiful.
Open palms is not a 5 versus 5.
You know what, man? It's okay. You don't have to know all of this, but it's okay. All we were doing was clarifying that it is going to be a 45-minute time limit, so hopefully we don't have any more controversy, hashtag FA drama, over the time limit. But fingers crossed that doesn't happen. Fingers crossed.
Yeah.
Very tightly. Very,
45
very tightly.
Minutes to make this work. I have seen very, very few open palms that ever went up to 45 minutes. I mean, I know it does happen. It does happen enough that you'll see some replays of it, but typically this is a short map.
So all of the combat is going on the left side of the map.
More Jesters dying to flak.
Yeah. Wow. Wow. You know, and I think that just sort of highlights the importance of making sure that you get the balance of flak to actual combat units correct. It's important. It's very, very important, as we're seeing quite convincingly here.
Yes.
Very important.
If you don't have enough, you're going to die to air, and if you have too many, you're going to die to land because you have more flak than you have tanks. I do like this. There are three Vipers under a mobile stealth generator that are just, you know, they're not doing a tremendous amount of damage. They're not doing anything game-changing, but just over the course of time, they're gradually laying in damage on these units that are right here. They'll eventually be able to kill off all those mass extractors and stuff. So, nice little positioning right there.
Well, you know, and in addition to the fact, you know, they're occasionally getting the unit killed, they don't even have to do much as long as they sort of rain down on top of those mass generators. Even if there's no combat troops over there, they are going to, you know, help take out some of Ajax's economy. So,
yes,
they are still fulfilling an important role.
The Jester rating has been upgraded to Corsairs.
Way!
We have moved from medieval to pirating, so that's going to knock out some mass extractors with ease, hopefully do a little bit more damage than those wasted gunships did earlier.
Mm-hmm. So it looks like Obfuscation is trying to target mass extractors with this Corsair. I think that's the case, anyway.
Yes.
Is that the right thing to do? Is it?
Well, I think the more important question right now is Ajax going to die?
Ooh, yeah.
Because he shifted to T3 on a lot of factories, and this was another full shift. There was no half-hearted measures here. It was T3 or bust. Typically, you'll see people move with the T3 HQ, get 4 or 5 Percivals online, and then one at a time start upgrading support Oh, good lord. Now he's got T2 bombers on his commander. Ugh, 6,000 health, double veterancy, overcharging the units. That was close.
Looks like he's going to manage to push it back, at least for now. Plus, Ajax has got Tier 3, so hey-ho.
He does. Hey-ho. I don't understand why he did that one full shift as well, though. As you can see, he lost all his map control.
Yeah, absolutely. He's sacrificed all of that map control he gained back with his perfect Tier 2 shift. Now, there's some people saying in the chat, a perfect Tier 3 shift? It wasn't a perfect Tier 3 shift.
I don't think I ever said that.
You didn't. Exactly. That's what I'm saying. You didn't say that. And it absolutely wasn't a perfect Tier 3 shift. I mean, he has given up a lot of map control for this Tier 3 that he now has. So
I would say losing map control is a fair bit more dangerous at T2 than it is at T1. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, basically he shifted 6 factories at one time to T3. So that means he's only got 2 Tier 2 factories pushing units. And yeah. all the rest of them are under upgrades. So his unit count just falls exponentially. As things die, they're not getting replaced. And that's where you get this whole situation where he lost two of his expansions. He's lost all of his map control. Yes, he does have a clump of Percy's online now. And yes, he may be able to make all of that ground back, but that just about killed him.
Well, the thing is, it was always going to be a risky strategy. You know, at tier two, it was much less risky, but
well,
now,
the tier two one, he didn't come near that close to dying on the tier two one.
No.
He lost a lot of ground. Yeah, he lost a lot of ground, but it wasn't unrecoverable. That one just about killed him, and this one may kill him right here. Oh, power snipe. That is bad.
Wow. That is going to hurt. That is going to hurt really, really badly. And looks like, is he going to target the commander? Is Obfuscation going to try and target the commander with the Corsairs? It looks like he might try to do that. There's not going to be much anti-air now that he's cleaned up all of the interceptors.
There's Mobile Flak moving out. Will it be enough to save him? He's down to 4,000. 3, 2.
Oh, no, it's not going to be. It's not going to be.
Oh, my goodness. 800 health.
Oh,
200 and boom.
Boom.
Goes the dying light.
GG.
And all those Percivals dying to artillery down here on this side. That was a roller coaster.
That was a good game. That was a good game. I mean, in the end, it was the fact that there was no air. Ajax had, he had some interceptors, but he really didn't have anything to counter, you know, the Corsairs that came out.
Well, that's all you need is the interceptors. The interceptors are for killing other air units. So having that tremendous cloud of interceptors was about the best thing he could have done, but he just didn't have enough of them.
He didn't have enough, no, because Obfuscation had way more interceptors, and he had Corsairs as well. So it was never going to be a favorable engagement, I'm afraid. It was a good game anyway.
It was great good. Game. That T2 shift was brutal. I would say it was well executed for what happened, and he did not lose nearly as much ground as he did with that T3, but looking at it, he was just holding even with his T2 when he took that T3 shift, and that was very foolhardy to try for that hard of a T3 shift with all those factories. Just about lost it there, and then the ground that he lost for taking that T3 shift gave Obfuscation the advantage that he needed to go ahead and win the air, take that snipe. That was... It was close, but that was a bad choice by Ajax, that whole T3 deal.
So you think that it was that tier 3 shift, that shift into tier 3 that ended up killing Ajax. Is that the case?
Maybe not entirely, but it surely didn't help.
The fact that you just don't have those tier 2 units streaming out, that just killed him. That just absolutely killed him, I think.
Yep.
But hey ho.
All right, so want to sum up rounds for us? We've got round two up here.
Oh, fantastic. Round two. Mr. Smith lost against Mad Mozart. Zlo was victorious against Luxy, and Luxy has crashed out unceremoniously out of the tournament, I think. Meffy won against a Thug for Life, and as we just saw, Obfuscation won against Ajax in what was an absolutely fantastic battle. It was great, as far as I'm concerned.
It was.
Top notch.
Round three. Looks like we've already got one result turned in because Luxy bowed out, so he is out of the tournament. Meffy gets an automatic point on that one. So our next games, we've got Mad Mozart versus Ajax. We've got TA for Life versus Mr. Smith, and Obfuscation versus Zlo. So it's going to be our choices for the next round. We're going to do another poll to see who we want to watch.
Absolutely. We are indeed going to do that. And I am working on it right now.
Fantastic.
All right. I will do it. I'm doing it. So I presume that we're not going to see Luxy in again. I mean, I presume he's just crashed out of the tournament. I'm not entirely sure.
Probably not.
Not keeping up with chat. So whoever's against Luxy next is going to get a free win. Looks like it was Meffy. Meffy is going to get a free win against Luxy. Fair enough. He chooses to quit. That's That's what you got to do. You know, you got to award free wins. Hey-ho. But that is a real shame that we're going to see somebody crashing out of the tournament already. But you know what? It was advertised as being salty. And you know what? So far, it has not disappointed.
No, absolutely it not. Has not. Even in the chat in the side, if you're reading it.
Oh, my goodness. Like, the drama is insanity, so to speak. Oh, topical there. Ooh.
Ouch.
No, it's just me.
It's bad when I make name puns.
Yeah. Ooh, okay. Let's just forget that ever happened. Okay. Okay, I am composing the straw poll right now so that everybody will have a chance to determine who we cast next. Now, I'm going to ask you a question here. It may or may not be a trick question, but who would you like to see in the next game? Who would you like to cast, Mr. Insanity?
Let's see here. Have we seen Mr. Smith yet?
You're supposed to answer, oh no, I'm not supposed to choose anybody because I'm casting it. That's what you're supposed to say.
Being misled here.
I am not misleading you in the slightest. Oh my goodness.
You're killing me, Potato. You're killing me.
I'm not trying. All right. Here we go. Okay. There we go. Some more spam in the chat.
We can link it one more time if you still didn't get it.
There we go. One more time. I did it. Oh, man. Is six times enough? Yeah, I think six times is more than enough. Absolutely. That's fine. Wow. This chat is fairly salty. I think that's fair to say.
Yeah, it usually gets that way. So we're just going to leave it alone over there in the corner.
Yeah.
And carry on with our lives as usual.
Okay, so the map for round three is going to be Loki. And the start time is 7:55 British time. And finish time is 8:40 UK time. So that is in just over 35 minutes. So chances are, once we get the results of this straw poll, we will be able to jump quite convincingly straight into a game.
I think we already can, yes.
Fingers crossed. Awesome. Okay, good. What are we seeing in the chat? People are saying, Zoc, chat logs are riot. Please stream the tourney chat. Would that get more views than our casts? Perhaps, actually.
I can put it up on the screen if you guys want to see it.
I think people probably do. I don't know if that's a wise thing to do. I mean, I feel pretty elitist.
Well, you know, a lot of the salt is actually higher up, because the whole argument with Mad Mozart and all that is way up at the top, and I am not going to go back over there and find that. So
yeah, that was some top-notch salt right there. Once again, just spamming the links to the straw poll. Tell us, ladies and gents, who do you want to see us cast? It is in your hands. So cast your vote. Have you voted, Mr. Insanity? Have you voted?
I have not. I have refrained from voting.
Good. I feel that we're
learning. Did I get it right that time?
Yes, you got it right. We're learning something from this experience.
Pass the test. Now I need my own montage.
All right. Top notch. Absolutely top notch. Let me just check the results one more time. We've had 38 votes cast. If you want to jump in, now is your chance. We're going to be closing the voting in around about 30 seconds, and then we are going to be jumping straight into the cast of the next game. So make sure you vote right now. No,
Patrick,
go on.
You need to link me the remixes of the salt that you did a while back, because that would be some epic buffer music for all of this. I think it was Patrick that did it. I cannot remember. Someone took some stream audio from, I think it was probably one from TA and one from Zoc, getting extremely salty on voice chat, and they made a dubstep remix out of it. And we need to get this music in here right now.
That sounds absolutely fantastic. Holy cow.
I don't know why I didn't think of this earlier. We should have been playing this the entire time.
Probably should have. All right. That is, you know, the great Lord that is me has decided that we are going to, well, not me, actually. It is thanks to the public vote that we have decided we are going to be casting the Obfuscation versus Zlo. That is the cast that we're going to be watching.
I should probably open the game instead of the chat box. Sorry.
Probably a good idea, actually. Over 50% of the people that voted in this have voted for Obfuscation versus Zlo. 29% wanted to see A Thug for Life versus Mr. Smith, and 20% wanted to see Ajax versus Mad Mozart. We're going to be watching Obfuscation versus Zlo. Absolutely fine with me. You know, they're all top-notch players. I don't mind who we watch. Doesn't make a difference to me.
Oh, all right, Cybern versus Cybern.
Is that so? What sort of length does that mean that this game is going to be? Is it going to be a fairly quick game, or are we going to see a mid-game sort of play?
I don't even want to venture a guess, because this map, you never know what's going to happen. Might even see a T3 rush. Who knows?
A tier 3 rush? Okay. Okay.
It is not out of the question.
So what is the standard way to play on this map? Where are the points of expansion? I mean, it's fairly difficult, you know, to expand to the plateaus, isn't it? The three extra mass extraction points. It's fairly challenging to do that without being picked off by a unit, isn't it?
Well, this map has a little bit odd flow lines as far as where units are going to be headed, because you have indestructible civilian walls in the center restricting you to a small pass right there. You've got plateaus to the sides that are going to force you to climb onto them from one of the access points and move around. You've got water on the back sides of the bases cutting off access back here. So for Cybern, you're pretty much stuck with Wagners, Bricks, or Engineers as far as that is concerned, or your ACU walking across. And then there's not a ton of early reclaim. So your expansion is kind of going to determine how much your mass income jumps by. There's some rocks around the sides up here that it's going to take a minute to get to, but you're not going to have any large mass dumps right next to your base. So this one tends to scale pretty quickly because you do have a bit of separation between the guys. But it really tremendously varies what is going to happen once we get down to the nitty-gritty. Okay. All right.
Absolutely. I mean, it's certainly a very interesting map. A lot of people in the chat are saying that this map is, I presume, difficult and interesting. So, yeah, it looks like this is going to be another interesting game. Who would you pin your hopes on in this one? I mean, who do you think is going to win it?
I gotta say, I'm a fan of the Mad Russian.
The Mad Russian?
The evil Russian Zlo.
The evil Russian Zlo. Well, I wouldn't say it to his face, but that's probably correct. fingers crossed he's playing the game right now and not listening to this banter.
I am sure he is concentrating to the best of his ability with a single-minded focus on this game.
I mean, we saw him absolutely ruffle stomp, as you would say, Luxy. So perhaps he can do it again. You never know.
Maybe. Know. Looks like Mad for Mouse in the chat is betting £100 on a T2 comm drop. If we see a T2 Cybern commander drop, that's gonna be something different on this map. I don't think I've ever seen one of those here.
So let me ask you a question. How would you think about setting up like an FAF gambling house? Like, I think that would be a pretty lucrative business, right?
I would not literally set up a gambling house because there might be some questionable legality there, but I do have news for you. There is actually a betting system built into the FA chat that is currently deactivated, and I really wish they would bring it back.
I think
you were able
great.
To bet on ladder games. People would have running credit totals for the month, and you could increase your totals or lose all of your money by betting on ladder games. It was kind of a hilarious system.
That sounds absolutely phenomenal. Holy cow, that sounds amazing. Oh, man. But, you know, nothing out of the ordinary has happened so far as I'm aware. You know, both players are just sort of expanding, you know, getting their information out, making sure that they have at least a little idea of what the heck is going on.
Yeah, trying to get a little bit of a raid by here, but these guys are going to be able to pick them off. We've got so many scouts out. I love it when I see that kind of thing. Just all the intel that you can get your little hands on. Get out there and grab it.
You know, I think, you know, intelligence is one of those things that is just so, so, so important. It just cannot be overstated enough. It is, or cannot be stated enough that, you know, intelligence just is, you know, is key.
Run, little engineer. Run! Oh, he's going to go for the reclaim. Yes!
Oh, wow. That was top level plays right here.
Bloatier.
Holy cow.
Bloatier lining up that hunter execution right there by means of engineer.
That was beautiful. That was phenomenal. I really liked that. I thought that was really cool. Oh, that made me happy. All right, I guess we can wrap up. I've seen all that I need to see. That was top notch as far as I'm concerned. That was great. Good. Let's call it there. Why not?
Okay. What do we make? 17 seconds on that one thing? No, I'm just kidding. I was going to let you go. I wasn't sure how far that was going to carry.
No, I was expecting you to jump in and say, no, don't be ridiculous. This is a great match, blah, blah, blah. But you know what? No. I just pittered off and just went off.
Sorry to leave you hanging out there in the cold.
No, you know what? It's okay. You know, what I've learned from this is that, you know, I can't rely on you to back me up. I just can't rely on you to back me up. You know what? That's okay.
So sorry.
So
I'll have your back in game, in stream. You'll just have to wander out into the cold, dark, alone.
That's like absolutely that. Fine. Now, it's important to note that Zlo is in the chat. We're gonna just pretend... You know, we're going to pretend that we don't know the result. I don't even know what the hell.
No spoilers.
No spoilers, yeah. Don't spoil it because, hey-ho, it's not even worth it. But, you know, we're going to continue casting this game because it looks like it's going to be very, very interesting. That is for absolutely certain. All right, so, you know, once again, it just seems to be random units versus random units. It doesn't look like there's been a amassing of troops, so to speak. There's been no large confrontation as of yet.
Little poking, little prodding, just seeing what's going
exactly.
on. We do have a T2 air factory upgrade going down for slow.
Exactly.
So it could mean either drops or Corsair snipes. One or the other.
What, in your professional opinion, do you think it will be?
Probably T2 fighter bombers. Maybe a gunship. Who knows? He does have really solid air control. He's got like triple the amount of interceptors. So he doesn't really have to worry about that much. And I don't see any anti-air whatsoever anywhere on the map. For Bloatier obfuscation, so yeah, any amount of air is pretty much gonna wreck obfuscation.
Yeah, and I don't really know. I mean, that commander is, you know, he's fairly far away.
T2 ACU upgrade.
Okay.
Really?
Is that interesting? That's interesting. I mean, if he's also going,
is this really gonna be a T2 ACU drop?
What? What?
Are we seriously going to be watching this? There's the T2 transport. There's the T2 ACU upgrading.
What? What is happening? What is happening? I have literally no idea.
All right, air closing in. Whoa. We're going to secure an air win for Zlo. Maybe, nope, winging towards the north. Kind of a little bit of an odd choice there. All the interceptors clumping to the south for Bloatier, trying to keep them alive. That is exactly what I think we're about to see. There's no combat units. I don't see anything else to drop. Wait for him to load up. Nope, engineers.
This is a fairly, you know, if he decides to do that, then that is a fairly all or nothing strategy, isn't it? I mean, if Obfuscation has units to back up his ACU, then, you know, that's committing a lot. I mean, if it goes wrong, then...
He's going directly after the commander.
Wow.
What?
Oh,
what is this madness?
The ACU has touched down, and we're now going to see the ACU is going to be placing some point defense down.
T1 point defense Rumble. Behind, and he's pushing the Mantis to cut off the commander on the front. Oh, no, this is bad. Bloatier is all out alone.
he is massively overextended. His commander is so unbelievably alone. Even that tier one gunship. Yeah. It's gonna start, you know, picking away at it.
Wow, absolutely. Someone's actually using the engineering suite on the Mantis to speed a point defense build. That's awesome.
That is pretty darn cool. And Obfuscation being trapped in the corner right now, slow microing his units, trying to minimize
the impact.
Before he
gets to the water.
And it looks like that is going to be GG to slow.
Maximum troll.
That was a very, very quick game, coming in at 10 minutes, 20 seconds. What a stomping.
That is
wow.
One of the funniest things I've seen this week. Now, see, here's the thing. There is now a force penetrating the base of Zlo over here. He's losing map control around the rest of all this stuff. I mean, if that hadn't worked, then he probably would have been in trouble. But let's face it, there was no way that wasn't going to work. Because total air control, T2 comm versus the T1 comm. Yeah, that's funny.
As I said, it was an all or nothing strategy. If it hadn't worked, then hey ho.
Yowzers.
But it did work, so I guess it is completely irrelevant. You know, anything else is just completely irrelevant.
All right. Let me move this back over here. All right. So our tourney. Looks like we have one game that is still not decided, and that would be Mad Mozart versus Ajax.
Okay, that is probably ongoing right now. Indeed, it looks like it is ongoing currently. But apart from that, you know, we saw Luxy, you know, dropping out of the tournament in spectacular salty fashion, and Mephi getting the default victory there. As we have previously talked about, Ajax versus Mad Mozart. The match is still ongoing. We'll update you with that as soon as we know. A Thug for Life managed to beat Mr. Smith in his game, and Obfuscation obviously lost against Zlo in the thrilling 10-minute, 20-second match that we just watched, literally just there. Man, oh man, oh man. Fantastic. That is great.
Alrighty then. Have we announced the round 4 map yet? Or has it been announced?
As far as I am aware, I do not think it has been announced. No, it has not been announced as of yet. Manreed is the person that is dealing with that. So no, I do not think that is the case.
Are we going to want to watch another game on Loki?
Hey, that is completely up to you. That is completely up to you.
I think we should probably ask that one to the viewers, because I was having a hard time discerning the response. Because there was some people that were saying, oh, cool, it's Loki. And then there's other people that are like, ah, no, Loki, what a terrible map. So if you guys want to see another game on Loki, we can probably have time to check out another game before round 4. But if y'all would prefer just to sit back, kick back, and wait on the next round to start, we can do that as well.
That is completely fine. I mean, we can talk about the weather or something that's completely unrelated. I don't know. I mean, whatever takes your fancy, man.
Well, let's see. Unlike 2 weeks ago, I didn't have a tree come down next to my house, so I'm not power stalling today.
That is a fantastic point. I mean, it was an act of nature that that denied you from joining the first 3 hours of the noob tournament stream with me. I mean, I'm actually kind of envious that you didn't have to sit through the entire 6 hours like myself. But
I did sit through the entire 6 hours. I just wasn't talking for 6 hours straight.
That is a very, very valid point. In fact, you know what? Now might be a fantastic opportunity to have a look at the leaderboard. I mean, we've had a look at the matches and the rounds and whatnot, but the moment, we see that Zlo is currently in first position with 3 wins. Obfuscation is, of course, in second with 2 wins and 1 loss. That loss was, of course, to Zlo in the last round. Mephi is on 2 wins, 1 loss, one of those being a default win, of course. And after that, we've got Mad Mozart, A Thug for Life, Luxie, Ajux, and Mr. Smith. So it's you know, it's all to play for at this point. But Zlo is definitely extending with his lead.
Can I promote salt? Because if you really want to get extremely salty, you could point out that Lu Xun has forfeited two rounds and is still higher scored than Mr. Smith.
Yeah. Wow. Wow.
Okay, I'm just going to stop there and leave that one alone. I'm sorry. Well, let's pick another game. Who else do we want to watch? Let's go ahead and burn another Loki match so we're not sitting here yakking it up.
Let's do it.
We just watched Obfuscation and Zlo. We've got TA for Life and Mr. Smith and Luxie and Meffy to watch. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Pick either one of those.
It's interesting to note that I don't think Mr. Smith has actually won a single game yet. I don't think he's even... No, he has drawn three games? No. He's lost three games, unfortunately. That is... That's a shame. That is a shame. Do we know what his ladder ranking is? Let me just check. I think he's
over 2K, if I'm not totally mistaken.
He's 1,900. His global rating is 1,900. I think apart from Meffy, in fact, yeah, I think apart from Meffy, he may be.
Actually jump into the Mad Mozart versus Ajax, which is currently still running.
Yeah, let's do it, man. Let's do it.
All right. Absolutely do it. I will launch it up.
Please do, because as far as I'm concerned, the more Forged Alliance that we get to watch, the better. Absolutely top notch.
Absolutely. All right, let's head out here then.
All right, who do you think's going to win? Who do you think's going to win this game?
Why do I always have to pick? Let's see. Who do you think is going to win? Even though you don't know anybody here, dark as to who's going to win.
My opinion is completely irrelevant because I, A, know very little about the game, and I also have no idea about the players, their past history. Commenting on the fact that I've seen a match with Mad Mozart in and commenting on the fact that I've seen a match with Ajax in, I would think Ajax, you know, and that tier 2 shift and how he managed to so quickly regain map control. If he can pull something like that again, then I think he's going to have no problem beating Mad Mozart. However, you know, Mad Mozart has, you know, he's proven that he can hold on. You know, he came back in the very first match against Luxie, so...
Did a damn good job of it, too, so...
He did a very, very good job of it. You know, hats off to him there. Absolutely.
So the question here is if Ajax attempts to pull another brute force tech upgrade.
Uh-huh.
The superior map gaining capabilities of Mad Mozart, is that just going to completely overwhelm him? And I guess we'll just have to play and see how that works out. I don't know that kind of tech shift is going to happen on this map, though.
Okay.
It's probably going to be more of a gradual thing. I would like to think, but I may be wrong.
Mm-hmm. I think it's probably important to note that Ajax managed to get his ACU round to the little expansion area quicker than his opponent. So I think that's kind of worth making a note of.
This is kind of strange, ACU placement. Honestly, usually it's either going to be like in a more forward position, trying to secure one of these outlying expansions, or actually like down here across the water, so that you don't lose your foothold on the land down here. So I don't know that I've ever seen anyone build those three particular mechs with the commander, but I'm not going to fault him because he has a way higher rank than I am. So more power to him.
More power to him. And his bombers are going to get some snipes. You know, Mad Mozart is managing to get to fairly effectively clean up those engineers that are straggling away from the pack. So good on him for doing that. Good on him for doing that. Just reading the tournament chat at the moment. Luxie's back, apparently. Luxie is back.
Fantastic. Well, he's not in last place, so theoretically he could actually make some headway in the last round.
Oh man, I don't think he's gonna get to continue. I'm afraid. I do not think he is. I mean, after that little tantrum, I don't think it's gonna happen. Oh well.
I do like the jesters. Mad Mozart is pushing jesters around the outside edge. Gonna clean up those couple of little mass points nicely. And that was a good raid on the reverse for Ajax over here. So we are seeing some steady full expansion towards the north and south, respectively. But these guys are not really jumping in leaps and bounds towards any corner. Although I do like this movement right here to potentially knock out this edge. Mm-hmm. Looks like Ajax is pushing T2, though.
I don't know about you, but it looks like, from my perspective, that Ajax is doing slightly better, although maybe that is completely wrong. Just the fact that he's got such a large mass of units down here makes me think that that may be...
He is barely breaking even on air, and he is quite a bit under on mass income, actually. 30 versus 40, and let's see, Ajax is on 3,800 reclaim versus... Okay, so he's 800 ahead on reclaim, but a little bit behind in mass. He does have a couple more Tech 2 tanks fielded than Mad Mozart does, but not enough to make that big of a difference at the moment.
Yep. Understandable. Completely understandable. Looks like Ajax is going to manage to push back that little northern invasion of Mad Mozart. But once again, there's a very, very scary force down here for Ajax in the bottom. That is scary.
Yes. But I have a couple of people commenting in chat. Not even a close look at the build orders. We are making up this second game while we're waiting for the next round to start. So I do apologize if I move through some of this too quickly for some of y'all. But this is a fairly long game. We're going to try to get back to the next round of tournament quick as we can.
For sure. Yeah. And, we will keep you informed as things progress and when we proceed to the next round of the tournament, for sure.
Little T2 tank flying away across the hills. Have to see where he ends up.
That's quite an idyllic image, actually, isn't it? It's quite quite nice.
Oh, he's going to get dropped. Is he going to get dropped in the back right here? Beautiful.
Well, if he gets dropped anywhere near those engineers, then that would be some substantial damage. But looks like he's going to be dropped next to those mass extractors and that hydrocarbon power generator. So,
and there go the jesters.
There go the jesters. Yeah. So,
if only there had been a flak.
If only. I know anti-air is just one of those things that you really cannot have enough of until you've got too much of it. But until you've got too much of it, you really can't have enough of it.
That was one of the more nonsensical statements that I've heard today.
Nonsensical? I think that's probably one of the most sensible things I've said today. I mean, I've said a lot of nonsense today.
You're right. It did make logical sense. It just took a long time getting there. So many jesters.
Exactly.
All right.
See, I think this is gonna put an interesting sort of spin on what Ajax sends out, because he needs to balance the fact that, you know, any tanks that he sends across to the western side is almost certainly going to get killed. Yes, that's a good point. Flak is coming out.
He's got flak on both sides, so he should be okay. And the thing about jesters, they only have, 525 health apiece? So a couple of volleys from that flak cannon, and all those jesters are going to fall down. So it's not going to be that hard to knock them out of the sky, even for a single flak cannon, which we're about to see here, I do believe.
So there is...
Well, maybe not.
Two flat cannons, and they're going to be flying right in. And how many are going to get taken out?
Black is taking the long way around.
Yeah, it seems to be. I don't think we've seen a single one fall. There goes one.
There goes the interceptors. That'll clean them up.
That was
hysterically bad flak placement.
Yeah.
The flak was exactly where it shouldn't have been.
Yeah, that's really daft. However, the fact that the jesters flew to the southeast corner means that they were quite easily able to be swept up by the interceptors, which is kind of cool. I think kind of cool.
Interceptors flying back over the flak and into a cloud of interceptors. So That is going to be a pretty much complete and total air loss for Mad Mozart, but he is still going to pull off a drop. Going to get that T2 or T1 transport all the way back into the base there, right past all those interceptors.
But, you know, that drop, while it may be effective, he's not got, you know, Ajax doesn't really have much to lose on that side, does he? I mean,
three T1 mass extractors. Yeah.
That's not really that significant. I mean, let's be honest, that's not really a huge deal. And he does have a lot of engineers, but that's probably about the only prize that's really worth killing, I suppose, on that side of things.
Yes.
But hey-ho, maybe that's just me.
Cybern tanks, it's kind of interesting the difference between the units as you're looking through these. You can look on pillars, they have the gun mounted on the top, which means that they typically don't have a whole lot of trouble with terrain, whereas the Cybern tanks, the cannon is much, much lower. That tank is flat as a pancake, and it fires a beam instead of an arcing projectile. So rhinos typically tend to have a lot more trouble on rough terrain, like you're seeing around the edges here, than the pillars do. So sometimes you'll see that hand an even greater advantage to the pillars than you would normally have over rhinos.
Mm-hmm. Awesomeness. So at the moment...
Yep.
Sorry, no, go ahead. No, go ahead. Absolutely. It's all yours.
I was just going to say, one of the awesomenesses of a full simulation game. Terrain impacts, unit impacts, all that kind of stuff. You got to work into your plan. It's not just a direct statistical representation of what shots might hit.
Yeah, yeah. Absolutely. So at 50 or just past 15 minutes in, who do you think has it? Can you call the game as of yet, or is it still too close to call?
Ajax is looking pretty dang strong. He really is sitting on a little bit higher income. He has got a really good grasp on map control. He's got Mad Mozart running ahead of him in a couple of places here. He's actually getting his ACU a bit far forward here, although it is T2 gun comp, so he should be fine. So overall, he's just looking very, very strong in the face of all of this, and he's pouring even more pillars out towards the left side. Obviously, the commander's here, so he's not going to be able to directly assault that position for a while yet, but he is doing a nice job cleaning everything up.
Mm-hmm. I think it's worth noting that Mad Mozart has actually reinforced, you know, the position around, or reinforced the area around his commander, as opposed to Obfuscation, who just had a lone commander up there, and Zlo was able to take advantage of that in the last game.
Lone commanders are prime targets.
Exactly. This commander is well defended, and it certainly looks like even an assault of this size by Ajax is going to be repelled by those 2-point defenses. So I think that's just something interesting.
He's getting eco upgrades like mad. Let's see, we got 65 mass income for Ajax, and we've got, looks like, 79 for Mad Mozart. Pulling in a little bit of reclaim there. We got 9,600 versus, holy cow, 17,000. Nearly double the reclaim count.
Wow.
On Ajax, which explains all of the extra tanks that he has.
Yeah, that certainly does. And another point that I'm just picking up from the chat at the moment is saying Ajax is stealing the good trees from Mozart. Interesting point, I think. I mean, we can see the engineer up in the sort of top leftern area. It's just picking away at those trees. Now, it doesn't look like a huge deal, but, you know, over time, it adds up. It adds up.
Oh, my goodness. I can't decide if that's that chat comment's being sarcastic or not.
I think it's being serious. I mean, every little thing you've got to take note of. Absolutely, without a doubt, you've got to take note of.
I'm going to laugh hysterically if Ajax is able to take this base right now, because he has a T2 commander with gun upgrade and all of this tank and flak force accompanying him. So there's not really a whole lot to stop him right there. Not much. Three tanks. And if he is able to close that out...
He doesn't even have any units, any air units that can threaten the ground forces. So,
well, there are two Corsairs, yeah.
He does have two that just popped out literally just now, I think.
It's the caster's curse. Game's trying to prove you wrong as soon as you open your mouth.
Yeah, my statement was immediately redundant. Fantastic. I love it when that happens.
Oh, Corsair's wreaking havoc.
Man.
But the commander has decided that anti-air and a shield is a better idea in the face of those Corsairs coming out.
That is a fairly advanced commander. I mean, that is very, very close to the main enemy headquarters.
And he is losing all of his air.
Wow. Wow, wow, wow. So, there was a slight little assault by Mad Mozart in the north, which we didn't really focus on, but it looked like it got repelled, I think. Either that or there was a retreat.
It got stomped by the Percivals that had just come out of the T3 factory there. So, yeah, it got shut down pretty quickly. Made a little bit of progress, killed two mass extractors, got some units up a little closer, but those were immediately reclaimed and recycled into shiny new things for Ajax's army. And, yeah, the net gain was not very significant on that one, if anything.
Yeah, yeah. It's good. It's looking really good, although we're starting to see Ajax's units just sort of streaming into the secondary base of Mad Mozart. And
so many point defense.
That's going to do some damage, but there is a lot of point defense there to try and repel that attack. Is it going to be enough?
Oh, he should have had some T1 artillery in that one, because he is just going to take a pounding from all of these point defense, which he can't quite kill because of the walls. And he has lost about a third of his tank force by the time he tries to get out of this section. Five T1 point defense doing an incredibly good job there.
He didn't even bother. I mean, at the start, he tried to engage the point defense, but in the end, he just sort of bypassed them and decided, hey, the eco is more important than trying to take out these point defenses.
Exactly. You've already committed. You don't want to pull your tanks back, because then you've lost tanks for nothing. But at the same time, you got to get them somewhere, because that's just not working. Look at the work these jesters have done. That's what happens when you haven't got air on your side.
Yeah, and, there is some interceptors, although they haven't moved out as of yet. Probably the threat of the even bigger interceptor wave from Mozart is ever-present. Now, these are Tier 2 mass extractors that are being threatened. So
Ajax just got his economy cut in half.
Yeah. That's not great. That is not great, and that is definitely going to postpone. Going to extend the length of this match without a doubt. Also, a little bit of a power shortage going on, I think.
Yes.
Power shortage.
Mad Mozart has very nearly caught up on reclaim. He's only about 1,000 short. He's sitting much better on his power situation. And he has just crippled a pretty significant portion of Ajax's expansions. It's nothing that's going to for sure knock him out of the game, but that was a hard, hard hit. And I think a large portion of that was this boondoggle right here. He shouldn't have gotten caught up in the middle of all those point defense. That was just bad unit management right there.
Wow. That was, I mean, when you look at it like that, then that is a very, very large swing indeed. And he sacrificed, you know, what is effectively a bunch of tanks for not very much. A couple of point defense and three mass extractors?
Yeah.
Not really. Not really. Yeah.
Air scouts coming out. Going to try to find something to kill, apparently. And trying to get T3 power up. He's rolling a lot of T3 support factories as well.
Wow, he needs the power. I presume he probably still needs the power at this point.
Yes, his shields are stalling, so he's still power stalling.
Well, that is not good in the slightest for Ajax. No, it is not. Goodness me. But it looks like Mad Mozart has got a fairly firm handle on his side of the map. I mean, there's a few rogue units of Ajax that are going to invade and try to threaten this little base. But
another run in with point defense there, losing several tanks and his only flak, and then immediately retreating into rhinos. So no good done there whatsoever.
Yep, that was just a shame, a shame. Nothing happened, but he did learn from last time. He retreated far away from those point defenses. He didn't overcommit to taking out, that little base up there. And that's just going to leave Mad Mozart with the economy, you know, that economic gain from those four mass extractors up there. So, hey-ho. It's nice to have more mass. You know, the more mass, the better, as far as I'm concerned. As far as everybody's concerned, I think.
Yeah.
But hey-ho.
All right. Just going to kind of buzz through right here because it is looking like a little bit of a stalemate.
Understandable.
For the Absolutely. People commenting on my mouse flickering, that is probably a side effect of the screen share. So
yeah, it is. It is without
yeah.
a doubt.
Yeah. All right. Looks like we do have some nice groups of Percivals moving out, but unfortunately the problem is still air in a lot of cases. There is not so much air online now. Some of it has gotten knocked off by the mobile flak, but now all of the land forces that Ajax has lost over the last few minutes, whether it was to point defense, to superior numbers of tanks, to air, whatever it was, overall, I think he has fielded more... He has fielded more land units. He just can't get them all clumped up together because they keep either dying, you know, getting picked off or separated. He does have a nice little grouping
wow.
now, but it just took him a while to get there.
Wow, did you see that absolute stomping of those units? Those Percivals
yes.
absolutely going to town. Holy cow.
Percivals
How
are brutal.
It
is by far. Yeah, by far the strongest T3 unit.
That was phenomenal. So it's very clear that he's seemingly scaled up to tier 3 to get specific access to these units to try and
yes.
Stomp on his enemy's face.
Bricks will sometimes give them a little bit of trouble, but bricks have lower DPS and I think lower health as well. Let's see, 9,000 versus 9,300. Yes. So, yeah, Percivals pretty much trump everything else. The only way you're going to deal with them is either very careful micromanagement of units to match their just brute strength, or overwhelming the air force of the other player and bombing them out, something like that. Someone pointing out that Mozart has T2 stationary artillery in the bottom here, which, yes, is kind of hysterical.
it's logical. That is absolutely logical. I mean,
did he reclaim
it? It looks like the little outpost that Ajax had to the south with a couple of shields in, where his commander used to be, has now been successfully dispatched by Mad Mozart, and it looks like that ACU is somewhat on its way home, but only halfway there. It's currently situated in the water,
yes.
So nice and safe for now.
This is an excellent use of trebuchets. Cybran T3 mobile artilleries, they have the lowest DPS by a fairly wide margin, but they have the highest area of effect. So that means that even though they're only doing a little bit of damage, they're doing that damage to 5, 6, 7 units at a time. And
yeah.
It just softens up these groups of Percivals, which are, as you saw before, pretty much one of the hardest targets in the game to crack. But if they're clumped up like this, you can see these shots impacting. It's going to be damaging 5 Percivals or 4 Percivals in an anti-air unit at a time. So that's just going to help
yeah.
make this a little bit more manageable as they're coming into the base so that Mad Mozart doesn't have quite such a hard time killing them.
Yeah, it's just going to chip away at those Percivals, which is very, very important. Okay, what are we seeing here? In
air
the turn
being
jet.
Won very hard.
Okay. Apparently, time is up in real time, but we're going to continue this game until we see the next round. That is for absolute certain.
Alrighty. This is nice play by Ajax. He's dropping a full T2 transport load of T1 engineers right where that battle just took place, so he can vacuum up all that mass. And good lord, he has a strap bomber.
Oh my goodness. A strap bomber, you say?
That is not going to end well. I like the movement up on the north. Mad Mozart trying to get some bricks in to the base of Ajax, but it's just not happening. Percival's too strong.
Oh man, Percivals are just epic, aren't they? I mean, they're just so powerful. Bam, 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 and half your stuff is gone. I mean, it's very impressive. What is Ajax going to be targeting with this strap bomber? I mean, obviously the strap bomber is now no more, but...
He was hitting
T2
mass extractors, which I think was pretty much the ideal target. He's heading for the same up on the north side, pretty much uncontested. And then he is doing quite a bit of damage on the south end to Mozart's base as well. So, just from both sides, top and bottom, Ajax is really cleaning out Mad Mozart at the moment. It's not anything he can't recover from, but it is bad.
It is bad. Yeah. Alright, so knowing what you now know, who are you putting on to win this game? Who are you betting on to win this game?
At the moment, I would have to say Ajax. Because the map control, the amount of units and the type of units that he has out, and then the superior air tech, that's just too much of a win condition for me. I don't really see, short of a cataclysmic accident with a Monkey Lord, I don't really see how Ajax could lose this one.
Okay.
Oh, there's the stationary artillery they were talking about.
Okay. That makes sense. So yeah, that's a fairly heavily armored area up in the north. So,
speaking of Monkey Lords,
and what Monkey Lord just dropped? Wow. Okay, that's big. That's really big.
Ooh. All right, Ajax, 56,000 reclaim, and pulling in 72 mass per tick.
Whoa! Let's just take a moment. He has plus 7,000 power. Like, holy cow, that is a lot of power.
Well, you can see when he reclaims, when his mass bar jumps up, he's only overflowing 34. And then building that strap bomber early takes a lot of power. So, realistically speaking, he is not that overbuilt on power for being in the T3 stage. But I think he could probably do without a little bit of that.
Well, it's just the combination of those two tier 3 power generators that has got him that far, I think. Okay, and how is that Monkey Lord progressing?
7,000 health.
7,000 health. It's getting there. It's getting
Mozart
there for sure.
Has actually stripped out Ajax for both economy. He's pulling in 120 mass per tick, and with reclaim at 65,000. He is about 5,000 ahead on reclaim. So even though he took all that damage, had all that raiding done over here, because Ajax has not been able to keep this stuff locked down, it is still a substantial lead for Mad Mozart. I may have to retract my earlier statements because...
Really?
Yeah. Okay. I did not realize that his economy was quite that strong.
It is. I mean, the fact that I think it was those gunships that really did the damage to Ajax's economy, and he just couldn't respond to it in any way.
Yeah.
But hey ho, you never know. You never know. It looks like to me that Ajax has got more ASF fighters than his opponent does. Although I cannot confirm.
There's only two for Mozart, so yes, he has far more.
So I'm right. Hooray!
Yes.
First time today.
Excellent observation.
Thank you.
For the people over in chat asking, I usually try to go after a Monkey Lord with a dozen Percivals just to be safe. Because the more Percivals you have in a clump, the less of them you lose before they kill the Monkey Lord. But I think 10 Percivals is more than enough to kill it. You're just going to lose a few of them. So... anyway, it's not that hard to stop a Monkey Lord as long as you have Percy's in the right spot.
Fair enough. Absolutely fair enough. But does he have 12 grouped Percivals? Or does he even have 10 grouped Percivals that are able to deal with a Monkey Lord should it emerge? And, you know, it will eventually emerge. I don't think he has them. He doesn't have those 12 grouped Percivals. I mean, he's got stragglers.
I think he does. He can pull them together. All you have to do is pull your units back to base and intercept the Monkey Lord at a closer location so that you can get all of that condensed into one spot. But I think at this particular moment in time, it is hitching up something terribly. I think the game may have ended. Time is up. Game is over. Get out. So we're probably not going to see the end of this. I think this was going to be one that was determined to draw over the time limit. But
I think so, yeah.
I think Mozart would have taken this had the game gone on longer.
Let me just have a little look, seeing what is going on. Ajax said, Roffle in the chat. Okay, we were kicked out of the game. It was closed. Wow.
Oh, my goodness.
Jeez Louise.
Over their time limit and holding up the rest of the tournament, so they were kicked.
Yeah, that's fair enough. That is fair enough.
People complaining about the rules of this tournament being dumb. For one thing, I have to agree with the tourney director at the beginning when the whole argument came up with, was it Mr. Smith, I think? Or maybe it was Mozart. I think it was Mozart. Read the rules of the tournament before you join.
Because
if you join up and you didn't know there was a time limit, I think there's a little bit of a problem there. And then secondly, putting a time limit on the match forces people to consider options that they may not necessarily have considered before. So instead of going for a protracted long game and you've got all this time to figure out how to kill everyone, well, you've got to kill them within this certain time frame. And if you fail, you might lose. But if you don't win it, you know, you're going to meet the consequences of having gone over the time. So I kind of like the idea, and it does help out people casting because then we're not stuck here for hours and hours.
I can appreciate that, but let me play devil's advocate and say, you know what? How can you really see some of the best Supreme Commander Forged Alliance in the 45-minute time limit or whatever? I mean, is that really viable? Is that really viable?
45 minutes is a long time for a 10K.
Is it, though? Is it?
It really is.
I don't know. I mean, maybe in real person time, but maybe not in the pro leagues. I'm not entirely sure, I'll be honest with you. I'm not entirely sure.
All right. I am going to say, before we launch into this next one, I am going to run and grab something to drink so that my voice does not completely fall apart. So I will be back in about 45 seconds to continue this.
Exactly 45 seconds. Do we have a
maybe slightly longer than that? Do you want to cut the audio for a couple minutes and take a break?
Yeah, let's take a break. Let's go to our commercial sponsors. Thanks to nobody for sponsoring us. We'll be back very, very soon, and we will have a straw poll that I will set up over the intermission. And you guys can vote on what we want to see next. Awesome. All right. You in a minute, guys.
All right, peeps, we're back.
That's right.
I think there is a link in the chat.
Yeah, there's a few. You know what? There's a few. Not too many. Not too many. But yeah, the next map has been announced. It is Rieger VI, which I presume is like Rieger 6. I'd presume Rieger 6. Does that make sense?
Yes, Rieger 6.
Rieger 6. The start time is 20:55, so 2 minutes ago in British time, and it will finish in 45 minutes from then, so that is 40 minutes past 9 UK time. All right. Sweet. Awesome. Things are progressing very, very nicely, and yeah, there is a straw poll that you can vote on right now, so please go and do that. Please, please do. Already got 25 votes in, and we want to see as many as possible, so, you know, this is a truly democratic way of deciding what games we're going to watch. Okay. Post it in the chat again 3 more times.
One of the advantages to being the moderator of your own chat, that spam rules do not apply.
Exactly. In fact, you know what? I think you're a moderator as well. So as far as I'm concerned, I think you can spam as well. I think so, yeah. I think I modded you.
What do you know? I have a little sword.
Exactly. Exactly. See, I trust you enough to be a moderator in my chat.
Do I get to use the sword to stab people who misbehave?
No, 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 no. That is not the job of a moderator. That is irresponsible.
What is the point of having a sword then?
Show and tell, I suppose. I mean, you can say to all your friends, hey, I'm a moderator in Orbit to Potatoes Twitch chat. I mean, how fantastic is that? How fantastic is that?
All right.
You know what? We were actually discussing something just before we went on, because we were discussing, hey, do we stream this on Orbit to Potatoes channel, or do you want to do it on Brink's channel? And something that I completely forgot about is that YouTube gaming, you know, this, or YouTube streaming or whatever, the service that is used to stream content on YouTube, it's actually banned in Germany. So anybody that's German wouldn't be able to watch what we live stream on YouTube. That's terrible.
If we did if we did do it online, I would move to Twitch. I know I don't stream on Twitch that much, but I would do it on Twitch, because that would just be unfair to the Germans.
Yeah, that would be evil. That's just, that's a real shame. Yeah. I don't know why it is banned. That's, Oh, well.
Copyright stuff.
Copyright stuff. Oh, yep. Copyright.
Extremely overly aggressive copyright stuff.
I have no idea. I have no idea. I'm not a copyright lawyer. I'm not a lawyer of any sort, actually. I'll be honest with you.
All right. Has everybody voted in the poll? Do we know who we're going to be watching yet?
Good question. We do have 35 votes in. There is still time to cast your vote, ladies and gents. I'm spamming it once again. There you go. Please vote right now. We've got 35 votes in. As many votes as possible, please. But at the moment, it looks like Zlow versus Mephi is 7 votes ahead.
Mm.
7 votes ahead.
Get to watch the evil Russian again.
The evil Russian versus Mephi, who I don't think we've actually watched yet, if I'm not mistaken. I don't think we have. I really don't think we have. And when I say yet, we could very well be looking at a game with Mephi. Although a Thug for Life versus Ajux just got a couple more votes, so...
Have we seen TA for Life play? I don't think we have.
I don't think we have either. No. No. No, we really haven't. But in fairness, we don't have the ability to cast absolutely everybody, so... that's worth pointing out. We're casting as much as we can. We're even recapping people. So, you know, we're doing what we can. We're doing what we can, guys. We're doing what we can. I think that's fairly fair to say. All right. Has that been 5 minutes? I think that has probably been 5 minutes. So let us wrap up the straw poll right there. Last second voting. If somebody votes right now, then it will still be counted. 19 votes, 46% of the votes is going to go for Zlow versus Mephi. Looks like that is going to be the game of choice. A Thug for Life versus Ajux coming in second place with 13 votes. That's 32%. So I think it is going to be Zlow versus Mephi.
All right.
Slow versus Meffy it is.
Well, we will get to see one new person. I don't think we've seen... Have we seen Meffy yet? I don't think so.
We have not seen Meffy. I was saying earlier that we haven't seen Meffy or we haven't seen A Thug for Life either. So
yeah,
we've seen everybody else, though. Everybody else. And it's been fantastic so far. Absolutely phenomenal. Absolutely phenomenal. But yeah, looks like it's going to be Zlow versus Meffy for the round four that we are going to be getting. Important to note that Mr. Smith actually won a game, but it was by default against Luxie. So congratulations, Mr. Smith.
I was about to start singing the Hallelujah chorus, and then I realized that might be a little too sarcastic in that.
yeah. Poor guy. The only match that he's won is because of a default match.
Good That's lord. Another Cybern versus Cybern. I love me some Cybern, but Cybern is really just taking over this tournament, to be honest with you.
Well, it's your favorite, so I have no idea why you're complaining, as far as I'm concerned.
We got Zlow on the north side versus Meffy on the south. And this is a highly entertaining map, if I do say so myself. I have a soft spot in my heart for this one.
I hate this map. It is horrific. I really dislike it. Thoroughly.
You dislike
thoroughly.
Playing it or dislike watching it?
Oh, I love watching every map. I hate playing this map. I mean, I am terrible at almost every map, so that's worth pointing out. But I dislike this map. I think the distance between the... You know, there's... What I mean to say is there's not really a safe expansion, is there? I mean, all of them are, you know, they're fairly separated. It's a large map. And the fact, if you're playing on a 2v2, then, you know, it's a real opportunity for your opponent to snowball quite easily.
Yes.
And yeah, that's just my opinion on it. But hey, ho. That's
right,
just me.
Pretty much identical builds going down for the first couple of ticks between Zlow and Meffy. Zlow... Both of these guys, they're doing four mass extractors, double adjacent land factory with the hydro linked as well to two P-gens, air factory. But that's where the similarity stops because Zlow is assisting his build with two engineers and zipping to the back with one engineer for the reclaim back here. And then Meffy sent the number two engineer to snag the reclaim, getting it earlier than Zlow did. But that means he's going to be a little bit behind getting his air factory up. So, slight variances. We'll see how they play out for these guys. But overall, very, very close to the same.
Okay, so if you had to, you know, once again, I'm going to ask you to pin your hopes and dreams on one of the players here. Who do you think it's going to be? Who do you think is going
to
win it?
I'm going to have to say Zlow because he has, what, 400 rank advantage? And yeah. I think he has probably done this a little bit more than Meffy has. Maybe not in recent days, but he's just been around a long time. So, yeah, I'm going to have to give advantage to Zlow. But again, anything can happen in a one versus one. And the global ranking comparison is not necessarily true of the ladder skill.
I mean, we have seen Zlow play. We haven't really seen Meffy play. So we can't really... accurately gauge what's going to happen, but yeah, I would think that Zlow probably has the advantage in this game as well. Probably.
We do have a perfect counter coming out though, because Meffy went first interceptor and Zlow went first bomber out of that factory. So there is another interceptor out for Zlow, which may be able to defend, but I think that bomber is probably going to get picked off before it can actually do anything. This is actually a cool posture because he has pulled it all the way to the border of the map in the back and landed it, and he's going to try to escape the notice, but he's going to find it.
Yeah, absolutely. Wow. Good players, but that was just not enough. Although, no, it goes. It's dead. It's dead.
It has hit the ground.
It has hit the ground. That is a real
people
shame.
In chat commenting, Meffy has to beetle snipe. It's the only way. Might not go that far, but yeah, it's going to be an uphill battle for Meffy for sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, without a doubt. Without a doubt. So we've not seen any players take their secondary hydrocarbon expansion. We've not seen anybody take a secondary hydrocarbon expansion. We're only seeing... a slow-ish sort of expansion to
You're speaking
the
of this?
Triple I'm speaking of that one and potentially the one in the left and right hand sides, the somewhat safer ones that are protected by a little bit of water. But
yes,
probably not going to see that one taken for a fair length of time, I would say.
Yeah, but they're both a fair ways away from the spawn, and this one especially is fairly exposed. You're going to see it get destroyed several times through the game. I know we've casted Rieger in the past, and that particular position would get overrun 3-4 times in one game. So securing it too early would be a complete and total waste, because the first couple of tanks that are going to come along are going to snipe off that engineer and kill any progress that was made.
So it looks like Zlo has pushed his ACU towards the middle of the map, whereas Mephi is going to go for the slightly more passive approach and chill out along the western side of the map and just build up a bunch of mass extractors over there, I guess.
Yes.
Fair enough.
Mephi's been able to slow down this expansion on the outside edge, which means that this reclaim is going to go unclaimed at least for the first little bit, and Mephi is going to be able to get up his reclaim. So that's going to boost him up a little bit. It is going to help for sure, but it looks like we're going to see an ACU push directly into the opposing base.
Wow.
Have to see how that works out for him. I don't know that he has enough units to pull that off. We'll just see how far up he progresses.
So we've got a couple of people in the chat saying Zlo is potentially going to park in the pond next to Mephi's base. What are the chances of something like that happening?
I'd say that is anything is in the realm of possibility. Well, it looks like he's building a point defense and throwing down some wall sections. So if he jumped in this pond, that would make a little bit of sense. I would almost think that with his ACU this far forward, with the Mantis support that he has, I'd almost be looking for a gun upgrade.
Yeah. I think that's probably a very logical way of doing things. Got some drops coming out. Okay. Fairly cool to see that happening already. I mean, at 5 minutes in, that's I don't know if that's early, but it's certainly on the quick side.
Delivering that's an engineer sure. out there. And that's going to probably service this upper plateau as well. Looks like we got the same thing going on for Mephi on this edge. Those three mechs, not critical enough that you have to get them super duper early, but hey, three mechs. So need to claim them at some point. And there's the reclaim engineer.
Yeah. So that is going to be a very, very juicy amount of mass. Do you know how much mass it actually is?
Let me see.
Is it control shift?
Oops, wrong one. Hold on. I'm in my wrong suite here.
It's
there
okay.
we go.
It's okay.
45 per rec, and then it's like a couple of hundred, I think, for the transport. So it's probably maybe 1,300, 1,400, something like that, at the top end, I would think.
Okay, that's fine. But, you know, whatever the case, it's still going to be a significant amount of mass, which is very, very nice indeed.
Someone telling me it's not the three mechs that makes the difference, it's the 3,000 reclaim that's up on this corner. And I can totally jump on board with that.
And so probably both players, I would imagine, are going to be parking some artillery outside and just beating away at those neutral point defenses
right there.
Up in the corner. Yeah, indeed they are. Fantastic.
Yep,
that's good to see.
And then reclaim the whole shebang. I do like those drops that just came out from Zlo a minute ago, because he had three engineers loaded onto the same transport that just dropped consecutive engineers. Expansion, reclaim, expansion, just to get all of that stuff taken care of. Very efficient use of that transport. I did not see where he dropped the three Mantis, probably off to help his forces on that side somewhere. And he's actually pulled that back, and now he is reloading it with six additional engineers.
So where do you reckon these engineers are going to go? Probably out to the extremities to just build up mass extractors?
Possibly right here. Looks like that's where it's headed first, and maybe a couple engineers directly to the ACU to throw some more build power on if he's going to try to get an upgrade.
But he
does have all these Mantis right next to his commander, which he can use to assist as well.
Oh, wow, so this is quite a collection of units that we're seeing in the middle right now. That's impressive.
More walls.
And Yeah, it looks like Zlo is going to try and fortify his position, going to try and cut his enemy off.
Yes.
Interesting sort of play. I've never seen this on this map before.
See, two, that's probably for radar. Maybe some reclaim with that one. There's the one engineer for the expansion on that side, and nice little push from Meppy. He is actually going to be able to secure this entire thing. Well done.
Looks like it. It will definitely be destroyed by Meffy. That is for absolute certain. Zlo did not think about that, although maybe he did, and maybe he just decided that concentrating his units in the central area would be more productive, perhaps. I'm not entirely sure. But certainly, at 8 minutes 36 seconds in, it looks to be an interesting game, just like every other game we've watched so far.
It's kind of intriguing how Zlo is pushing so much of his stuff directly to the center, and Meffy is securing the outsides.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure how this is going to end up. It's,
wow.
The problem here is that he's not going to be able to push his Mantis across into the base. I think what he is probably trying to do is get this secured enough that he doesn't have to worry about large unit flow towards his base right here if he leaves his flank unprotected. And he's going to get denied by those point defense right there. So,
yeah,
poking and prodding, as we've been seeing.
Yep. Pulling out of that engagement over there. Fair enough.
And point defense everywhere.
Everywhere point defense. More point defense. You can never have too much point defense.
Well, never. I wouldn't go that far.
Well, until you have too much point defense, you can never have enough point defense.
Apparently, Zlo has decided that he does not need an avenue of retreat. So he's just going to wall himself in with the enemy for a cage match.
A cage match. Oh, I like a good cage match. Can't go wrong with a cage match. It's going to be interesting. So what do you think? You think we're going to see some commander-on-commander action? You reckon?
Possibly, but I am actually very impressed with Meffy at the moment. He is pulling in just, I don't know, 70% more income than Zlo is, doing very well as far as map control is going. You can see he is dropping engineers off, harassing the edges, claiming everything that he can get his mitts on, and overall just making a very good showing for himself. Of course, Zlo is hanging around right at the doorstep of his base, but as long as he's not in the base, you know, you don't really have to worry about it. And there is the T2 shift. Meffy getting T2 tanks online.
Wow. So, I think, you know, Zlo has sort of gone for the, I don't know, I want to say stagnant approach. He hasn't really been investing all of the unit production in exploration and expansion. And as such, I think he's, you know, he's not going to be able to accelerate as fast as Meffy is.
He got really, really focused on the center. And I think that center push, if he had come on a little stronger, or maybe had dropped that gun upgrade and dived straight in, he probably could have done a ton of early damage. But as things stand at the moment, he basically just exerted himself early, or overexerted himself early, and just wasn't really able to make the difference up to this point. Now, that is going to shut down. That's the danger of the Medusas. Wow. You can see all of those T2 tanks wiped out because they were stunned by the T1 artillery.
Wow.
Yeah, that was kind of horrifying, to be honest. So Zlo is still in it. I thought that was going to end a lot worse.
Without a doubt, both of them are still in it. That is, I mean, he's being very, 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 very aggressive with his commander, Zlo, here. I mean, he's pushing, but now a push from Zlo against Meffy's seemingly out-of-place ACU.
Oh. He's going for killer bust. That was a factory build to trip the ACU. He's trying to swarm with Mantis to stop him from running into the water. It is all or nothing right now. Zlo realizes that he has lost map control. And in
the goodness. Water.
Holy cow.
Oh my goodness. So unbelievably close.
Meffy taking the T2 upgrade to gain that extra health and regen while he's in the water.
Wow. Wow.
This is an eclectic bunch over here. You've got like green and blue all interspersed on this side because not much attention is being paid over here. They're just kind of, eh, whatever. We'll shove some units over there.
Seemingly so. Wow. I mean, that was so unbelievably close there. I mean, what was that? 1,200 health that ACU was left on?
Yes. That's, and that was a huge flip-flop right there.
Yeah.
Mephi had superior mass income, superior unit composition and count, and he had the fortified position right there, and Zlo just wrecked his ass with that Medusa spam. I mean, the Medusas came out, stunned all the T2 units, and then the Mantis just consumed them.
Wow. Wow. And what we're seeing now is we're seeing Mephi trying to recover from his, you know, very, very dire situation as far as I'm concerned. I mean, it's going to be difficult. It's going to be very, very difficult. And it looks like there is going to be some commander sparring, which is exactly what I wanted. Hurrah.
Yes, but the difference here, you can see his health count already up to 8,000. We got a T2 commander here. That is going to be very dangerous if Zlo gets too close, because you can spam up point defense very, very quickly with that commander. And it's going to have a lot, a lot of regen on it.
What are we?
Does Zlo have overcharge? I don't think he does. 400 and boom.
Out of position. Holy cow. GG by Zlo. Zlo has been defeated. Holy cow. Did not see that coming.
No, that shouldn't have happened. He had all these units in the back. Did he not have... He had overcharge. He must not have had power.
He really had his ACU out of position there. I mean, there's a few people noting in the chat that Zlo didn't even have his plateau. So, you know, he'd missed out on that, you know, he didn't have that up there at all.
Yeah.
I mean, he hadn't even built the mass extractors.
He didn't get it till about, I don't know, what, 3 minutes ago? Is when he finally got a hold of that.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, his play with the stream of units that were heading into the middle, it was gutsy, you know? I'll give it that. It was very, very gutsy. And it looked like it was going to pay off, but because he just couldn't get that kill on Mephi before he crept into the pond, it just wasn't meant to be. There was no strategy after that, I guess. I just don't know. Yeah. I just do not know.
He was making a ton of progress around the map. I think had this drawn out, he could have potentially gotten the map back under control. I'm not saying that he would have. The T2 is nasty to deal with, but he was doing better on map control. But like you said, just the commander being out of place.
Yeah.
Killed off right there. Whew, buddy.
Yeah. Wow. Great match. Absolutely top-notch match. And now we will be progressing into the next round. Oh, man. Fantastic. Round 5, the very, very last match. And if we have a look, if we just scroll down for 2 seconds and have a look at the scoreboard, we will see that there is, how many? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 people on a score of 3. Oh, man. Oh, man.
Might help if I press the refresh button.
It's so close. It's so close.
So is there a tiebreaker plan?
I have no idea. I have no idea. I presume they're probably just going to do it on points difference. And when you look at it via points difference, even that doesn't really help clear things up at all. I really don't know. I really have no idea. But anyway, I shall prepare the straw poll for the next game that everybody can vote on, and that'll be up in around about a minute and a half. Probably a minute and a half.
Yeah. People commenting in the chat, 1400 HP is not close.
That was close.
Not necessarily close by the health count, but the missteps because of the Mantis in the way and the factory in the way, that kind of thing. We're talking about 14% HP left. And just one more turnaround with the ACU, running into a tank and having to redo the pathfinding, turning around, losing 2 seconds of time. Just one more tank collision could have potentially killed him. So, I mean,
how can you say that's not close?
That's
is
close.
So unbelievably close.
When you have, 25 tanks right next to your commander,
you're
counting the fractions of a second at that point.
Absolutely. So. Couldn't agree more. So, Mephi pulled it out of the bag. He absolutely pulled it out of the bag and went on to beat Zlo. Who would have thought? I wouldn't have thought.
Well done to him.
That.
All right.
Absolutely.
We've got Zlo versus Mad Mozart, Mr. Smith versus Ajax, or Obfuscation versus Mephi. And if you would rather spell Blodir, Blodir, than Obfuscation, everyone will know what you mean.
It's too late now. It is too late now. It's already been submitted. The straw poll is out there. Ladies and gents, please cast your votes on who you would like to see in the next match, because it's going to be fantastic. This is the last round. This is the final round. The final round. It's going to be good.
Looks like several of these guys are already in their games. So
yeah,
you shouldn't have to wait too long once this vote comes in. I'd say just a couple of minutes.
I think we will not have to wait very long at all, considering the start time was 7 minutes ago and the end time is just under an hour. So it's how do I say that name of that map? I have no idea.
Roanoke.
I presume that that's a big one, right?
Roanoke?
I 20 by 20, I presume so. If the time limit is 60 minutes.
Yes.
Yeah.
That would be the big one.
I thought so. Couple of seconds left to cast your votes, ladies and gentlemen. Obfuscation versus Mephi looks like it's going to be the most interesting. The highest voted map, or the highest voted matchup of round 5. But there is still time to cast your vote. Make your voice heard. So still time. So please go ahead and vote on the straw poll.
Look at me right here, just out of habit, browsing the browsing the Find Games tab. Whoops.
Understandable completely. Oh, man. Oh, what do you think of the tournament so far? Like, how do you reckon it's gone?
I thoroughly enjoy watching the high rank players because it's kind of like I said at the beginning, there are some crazy, crazy things that happen, in the 800, in the 1000, in the 1500 rank games. But when you get up at this level, you just don't see the glaring errors. You don't see massive failures most of the time. You see solid, tight gameplay. A lot of times you see really cool things going on. It may not be flashy to the common observer, but there is so much stuff going on in the intricate details, all the little raiding around the edges, all of the little unit manipulations and micro, that kind of thing. It's just really intriguing to watch.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, I think without further ado, let us just go ahead and announce the match that is going to be casted. It is going to be Obfuscate. Oh no. It's now a draw on 16 votes each to Obfuscation versus Mephi and Zlo versus Mad Mozart. Oh man. Mm. 16 votes either way. I mean, unless you want to call it, I don't know. What do you want to do, man? What do you want to do?
I think the first one that gets a vote needs to take it.
The first one that gets a vote. Okay.
I'm going to
watch with intense clarity. Intense clarity? That's not the word that I was looking for. Intense clarity. No. Well, you can tell that we've been streaming for what? Like almost 4 hours? We've been talking for almost 4 hours, so.
Yes.
Man. Oh, you never guess, right? They each just got an additional one vote, and I wasn't watching to see which one got the vote quicker. Zlo versus Mad Mozart is apparently going to be the game that we are going to be watching. Interesting choice. Not sure I would have chosen that one myself. Not going to lie.
Well, hey, we may be able to fit two in. Who knows?
We may be able to fit two in. Good choice. But Zlo versus Mad Mozart is the game of choice of the people. that's the way it's going to be, unfortunately. Hey-ho.
All right. Roanoke Abyss.
Oh, this map.
The big one.
This map.
Everyone is kind of secluded on their own little island. And yeah, air is important. Navy is even more so. Got air going down. Oh my goodness. Mad Mozart in before T2, T3 comm drop. And wow. It's Cybern versus Cybern again.
And I think if I'm not mistaken, the nationality of both of these guys is Russian. So
I believe you're correct.
It's going to be Russian versus Russian, Cybern versus Cybern. It's going to be great. It's going to be great. It's going to be great. Oh, man. Top notch. You know what? Let me just interject for a second here and say that I despise this map probably more than the one that we watched previously. And when I say I despise it, I really dislike playing it because it is just, it's so difficult. It is so unbelievably difficult.
I'm not a fan of this on like one versus one. It's okay sometimes as a team game map, but what really excels on this map is the Phantom games. I don't think that I have played one of those with you yet, and we really need to do that. But Phantom is where you have everyone is on their own. It's basically free-for-all, but you're all on the same team. And it's kind of like, I don't know if you've ever played Mob or something like that, but basically there's a traitor in the midst. Two of them are Phantoms, and the goal of the Phantoms is to kill every single other person in the game. And then there's one paladin who helps the civilians, and then the civilians are just random people. So basically, you have to figure out who the Phantom is and kill them before they kill you. And it can get kind of hysterical.
That sounds amazing. I want to just point out what Mad Mozart said. They said, do you think they're streaming our game? I don't know. Perhaps we are. We are indeed. Okay, the chat is saying Mozart will do drops, apparently.
Oh, well, I think they're correct. Because there's the drops.
Yeah. I really have no idea how you're supposed to accomplish this map without drops. I mean, it's just essential, isn't it? It's just essential. You can't survive without drops, I don't think.
Especially not on a map like this where you're this spread out. You simply cannot take the islands fast enough with engineers. It just will not happen.
Yeah, yeah.
You see, we already got transports building for Zlo as well. So he's going to be dropping engineers off to the side islands and trying to get his foothold down there. And this is a lot of naval factories going down out front for Mad Mozart right off the bat.
It looks like Mad Mozart is doing, I don't know, a tad better than Zlo. Maybe that's just my perception of things, but I'm not entirely sure that's the case. I mean, the early transport went out earlier by Mad Mozart. The naval factories have been put down earlier by Mad Mozart.
Oh, good lord. Look at all the factories.
Wow.
It's a different style of expansion. Basically, Mad Mozart is taking a tiny little bit of a hit early on eco in order to get his expansions out faster. Zlo is condensing his operation to get, you can see he's got four air factories online and a huge air presence already, whereas Mad Mozart just has one and he has a single solitary interceptor. Well, actually two right there. Zlo is going to expand, and he may be a little bit more secure in his expansions, depending on how things go. But it's just two different approaches, fast expansion versus careful expansion with a more established infrastructure.
So do you think it's a possibility that Zlo is going to be playing this game safe? You know, he went for some really interesting strategy last time. Is this game going to be safer, do you reckon? Has he learned his lesson in regards to the last game that he's played? Genuinely,
it is way too early to answer that, but what I'm seeing here is a pretty standard heavy air build that will get you out where you need to go. But one thing he is going to have issues with is the fact that Mad Mozart is pushing out an insane amount of frigates. Like, he's already got three factories down. He has got three frigates in the water already, and we've only got one naval factory with a quarter-built frigate for Zlo. So if these frigates can get to these outlying islands quickly, they'll be able to shut Zlo down pretty effectively.
So do you think that it's going to be Zlo that is relying more heavily on air than his counterpart? I mean, I'm not entirely sure what's going to happen in regards to that. I genuinely am not sure. I mean, bomber spam, that's being said by a couple of people in the chat.
Yes.
I think that could be a possibility. Absolutely, I think that could be a possibility.
And that's one of the perks to having full air control, because then you can pretty much field as many bombers as you want. You don't have to worry about it. I will say, as the match goes on, that gap is probably going to close, because when one player really heavily invests in air, typically it's a temporary lead, because then the other player sees, oh, they've got 10 times more air than I do. I need to produce this really, really hard. And then they'll just blow past them in production all of a sudden. So it's typically a short-lived advantage, but it is definitely advantage that you want to take, use.
Sorry, no. People are saying in the chat, he's got a Tech 2 air factory upgrade. A commander
right there.
Drop? Is this... You know, that ACU is getting an upgrade of some sort, I think.
He is getting the T2 upgrade on the ACU, and there is a T2 factory upgrade on air. Yes.
Wow.
It could potentially be a commander drop. Yes, I definitely would not doubt it, but I think it may be a little bit more reactionary to get this torpedo bomber up, because he simply does not have the Navy to deny what is headed towards him, so he needs this torpedo bomber support. Because T1 bombers just aren't going to do very well versus frigates.
Yeah. Yeah, so you think there's no possibility that there's going to be a commander drop, an ACU drop?
Oh, I did not say that. It is well within the realm of possibility.
Okay. Well, this is going to be an aggressive play by Mad Mozart here. Going to probably polish up this entire island, I would think. I mean, there's not much that stands in his way.
No, there's not. No point defense, nothing.
No, nothing. That's going to be costly, actually. That is going to be really, really costly.
Nice little grouping of frigates on this side. So that's going to be Navy win for Zlo, but then land win for Mad Mozart. It's going to lose that entire expansion, I think.
Well, unfortunately, you cannot get any mass income from a naval presence. So I think that is really going to hurt on land, losing that island.
But, you know, you can always get reclaimed.
That's a good point. That is a fantastic point. Reclaim for the win without.
Oh, there goes the commander. T2 comm dropped to the side island.
Well, chat called it. Chat did call it.
He's going to zip right on in there and re-secure his island with that commander. If he can keep the T2 transport alive, he can actually redrop pretty easily. But for now, he is going to be able to eliminate that threat. Very, very easily.
Yeah.
Don't land. You're going to die. Interesting Interesting point of fact. You saw the T2 transport for Cybern can actually stun units. It does essentially no damage, but it does have a stun effect on its cannon.
Interesting. Interesting without a shadow of a doubt. There's a couple of people in chat saying, yeah, if Mad Mozart managed to learn or sort of teach himself, I don't know, if he begun to realize that Zlo does take advantage of this whole Tech 2 commander drop mechanic, then without a doubt, I think that could easily get shut down by a few well-trained interceptors. I think that's totally a possibility.
You definitely do not want to try to pass through a cloud of interceptors. With the ACU. And then, in addition to that, if you do miss the transport, you can kill the transport as it's taking off from dropping the ACU and try to eliminate that. And that will leave the commander stranded way out in the middle of nowhere, which is an awesome opportunity for a snipe.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that's totally correct. But it looks like Zlo will manage to retake control of that eastern island. But I don't know. I mean, 10, 12 minutes in, how is it looking? How's it looking?
It is looking like it's favoring Mozart pretty heavily. Look at the income over here. We got 95 mass per tick, blipping over 100 with reclaim versus not even 60. And that is showing up in the naval unit count because they have about the same amount of factories, but Zlo is having problems getting enough frigates in one spot to prevent these guys from running around and killing things they shouldn't.
Yeah. Yeah, so, you know, at this point in the game, are you calling it? Are you going to call it a mad Mozart victory?
No, not at all. He is in
Go ahead.
I was just going to say, he's in a very strong position, but TA can recover. I mean, it is far from a lost game.
I mean, just taking a look at the score, which I know is a very, very bad way of comparing, but that's a 7K difference, and I think that's probably one of the biggest score differences that we've seen this tournament, I would imagine, actually.
What worries me more than the score difference is the fact that Mozart just dropped a T2 factory. That means that he is going to be able to push cruisers out, and that's going to shut down the air control and the torpedo bombers from Zlo, and I think that is actually going to be what shuts this game down. Mass advantage like that is not necessarily game deciding. You can see Zlo is already trying to match that up. If he's not power stalling, he's close to it and making it with reclaim. We got 2,000 advantage for Zlo on reclaim, but when he loses the air control, when he can't drop his commander around, that's going to be the end of him. And that cruiser is a bad omen.
Yeah. Yeah. So you think that is going to be the definitive final straw for this game in Mad Mozart's favor? Is that what you're telling me?
I think it's going to be one of the bigger influences. At this kind of game on this size of a map, you don't want to call it till it's over. Case in point, absolutely. I just had a game that someone sent me last week where someone lost, literally completely lost, no map control, basically just their ACU and maybe 20 units stuck off in the corner of the map out in the water, hoping they wouldn't be found, and nuked the other player with a hidden strategic sub, his last combat unit, basically, and won the game. So you never, ever want to count a game out until the ACU